Good afternoon, everybody. This is supposed to be an anniversary session. It's going to have two parts with a little in between where I will ask our guests to say a few words. First, I'm going to have a reminiscing, I will say, hopefully not too nostalgic view of what these 30 years have meant for Complas and Thymne. A little overlooking also on the current situation and perspectives for the future. And after the presentations from our colleagues in the table, Professor Roger Owen will give us his personal view on the future of all the past, present, and future of computational plasticity. Okay? So, in a relaxing mode, let me go back in time, too far away, but far enough, maybe, for some of you. I ask how many of the participants in the Complas course were attending or were born in the first Complas in 87, and about half of them were not born there. Let me say that we represent here, many of us, a very old profession, civil engineering. We're very proud of that, but this doesn't mean what it used to mean. Now, civil engineering means many other things, as you know, and I will refer to this later on. But this is a reference because being a civil engineer myself, you know, in the prehistory, I have to mention the links with this little town, not so little, but this beautiful spot in Wales, Swansea, where I went there in 1975. Okay, so. And you have all heard about Swansea, but what is amazing is, it's really nice and something to protect, that this cooperation that started in 75, this conference is one of the outcomes of this more than 30, I would say, already, with 42 years of links between Swansea. But actually, you know, life, as you know, is a journey, and, you know, sometimes you go to crossroads. Professor Sienkiewicz was the leader of Swansea, needless to say. But in 1978, you cannot see it very well. Can I ask Manolo to maybe to dim these lights? In 1978, there was a conference on numerical methods and applied numerical modeling in Tarrasa, the city of Tarrasa, a school of mechanical engineering, by the way, because I had done a thesis on metal forming. I was invited there. Authors Oñate, Hinton, and Glover, and the paper was Techniques for Improving the Performance of Isoparametric Shell Elements. It was the day of the heterosis shell and plate elements, those element technologies that are history, but are very much used. And from that time on, I joined the School of Civil Engineering. This picture shows that I was not really against any practical engineering. On the contrary, those days we had to really be involved in building the university labs, civil engineering labs, or really taking students in practical visits to tunnel. This is the Cadiz tunnel linking the north part of Catalonia with the Pyrenees. Yeah? Okay, and just in case you don't recognize me, this is myself. You know? But everything actually started in a more formal setting in 79. That means a few months after I arrived in Barcelona, together with my, by the way, hired by Professor Castellero, who's sitting here in the second row. In December that year, I asked my colleagues in Swansea, Roger Owen and Ernie Hinton, why don't we organize a course on final elements applications in engineering? This is the design of the leaflets. You can see we designed it ourselves. What is really, I would say, extraordinary is this course was run for 11 consecutive years at Christmas. This was December 79, so when Christmas came, our colleagues from Swansea will come to Barcelona and then they will have courses. First, one course, then basic and advanced. Eventually, the basic course survived. The advanced course was found too advanced for many people. But these are editions of the course, and these are the kinds of books we were actually using in those days. The Introduction to Finite Element Programming, Introduction to Finite Element Computations, published by Pine Ridge Press those days, and the book on functional medicine plasticity. And I recall by the 1980, Professor Owen already promised the second edition of the book. Well, it took a few years, actually, but it finally eventually came. I hope some of the students have even purchased it. But this is referring to the story of this joint relationship. Many courses follow now in the formal setting with the university on numerical method, and this is all before, you see, 85, 86. This is 87. Yeah, we are approaching the creation of FIMNE, always together with Swansea. And then we decided in 82 to have the first conference, the first Spanish conference in 82, this is 5 years before FIMNE, the first conference on numerical methods in engineering. Right, and then it was fairly successful, and then Cedric Taylor, at that time organizer of the first conference on numerical methods for nonlinear problems, approached us together with our colleagues from Swansea and said, why don't you organize an international conference? And we did the second edition, and it was 84. Okay, I had taken this picture from those days. Here is Cedric Taylor. This is Roger Owen here, Annie Hinton, and guess who is this really young-looking gentleman? It's Tom Hughes. Okay, this is Richard Wood, and this is Jack Donin. Okay, so this is in that conference. We said, okay, nonlinear problems is too general. Why don't we focus in a specific field? And this was the birth of computational plasticity. It was the birth of computational plasticity in 1987. In April 1987, we had the first conference and the first course, including plasticity in crypt those days, you see? And we have used so many times the Sagrada Familia as an icon for our events, you know, because it actually contains many reference to elements. And this is the picture of the opening of the conference those days, late Annie Hinton, who passed away a few years later, and some references to the course. This is how we actually were organizing the course. This is Roger lecturing the course. These are the students in this course that took place in the old School of Civil Engineering where the actual rector house is today. Okay, this is the old school, this is where the rector is today, and the conference took place in the chapel of the school where the supercomputer is today. This is me talking, and everybody was lecturing from the pulpit, and you can see here that we had advanced multimedia facilities here, and this is what we used to project some videos during the lecture. Okay. Now, COMPLAS 2 came the following year, 3, 4, the following COMPLAS. Then we organized the ECOMAS event already. By then, FIMNE was already existing, the ECOMAS event in 2000. This was a big conference, and I will not go, of course, into all the details. By then, one day we decided to skip pictures of monuments in Barcelona and move to more conceptual concepts. But of course, there was not a conference that was planned to follow the next one. Always, Roger and I will meet. This is after Annie Hinton died, and thought about the next conference. This is one of those meetings. You can see it was a very important meeting during this occasion. COMPLAS 10, 11, COMPLAS 12, again referring to different spots of Barcelona. COMPLAS 13, and we are now in COMPLAS 14, COMPLAS 2007, okay? Right. Some pictures, a few pictures about COMPLAS life. I'm going to refer mainly to people who actually has passed away. You know, this is Ted Belisco lecturing one of the sessions. Juan Carlos Simo. You all have heard of him. He passed away very young, in his early 40s. Mike Crisfield here, talking with Peter and Riggers and Roger. I put also some distinguished lectures like Professor Bazan, just to extend this this album to all of you because I could not collect many of those. But also, I would like to include Francisco Armero, who is not coming anymore to our conference, but he was a student in this university, and then after doing his PhD in Stanford and Berkeley, he came to this conference many times here with Bob Taylor and his wife, Adnan Ibrahim Gebogic, and Professor Stein, who will be joining us later in the week. I don't think he has arrived yet. Who are, I think, names that I will refer. I would like to mention that this conference was strongly supported by the Catalonian government. They even offered us a few times the Palace of the Government for the dinners. This is one of these dinners at the Generalitat de Catalunya, at the Salon Sant Jordi. And here we see also Ernie Hinton and Tom Hughes and Roger during, excuse me, Ted Belisco, Tom Hughes, and Roger, and Ekehard Ram profile showing there. Right, Complas life was full of anecdotes. There were places where we will go again and again for five consecutive times, and then we abandoned that. One was the place Los Caracoles, which is a place near the Ramblas, and this is a typical porron. You will see more of that later. That is something that it was compulsory for most of the attendees to those dinners to try. Okay, how do I relate this to theme name? Well, you can see it was relatively easy to convince in those days the university and the Catalonian government the need to formalize the existence of a center around the concept of numerical methods. Okay, in fact, we included not only research, we included also training of research and also dissemination and technology transfer. And what we told, the aim was, at those days we used two sentences. One is to bring organization next to a group of talented people. We had really a unique collection of lecturers in civil engineering, but we were lacking organization. And second, that the multidisciplinarity, we will cover different fields. But it was not possible until a person called Geoffrey Hollister, by the way, Geoff Hollister and Sienkiewicz edited a book on stress analysis, was appointed by one of the executive directors in UNESCO. And Hollister actually launched a network for computer applications in technology. And he, by that time, Professor Sienkiewicz was in Barcelona coming quite regularly, and then he said, you have to create a center to be a member of this network. And this is how THEMNE was created. It was a very formal, actually, event. First, we brought the Director General of UNESCO, Dr. M. Bou, to Barcelona. He became an honorary doctor of this university. This is with Professor Castellero. This is the formal act. And this is the signature of the agreements that led to the creation of THEMNE in March 87. Okay, so this is how it all started. What we did is we took whatever we were doing, we took Complas courses, conferences, and any other activity, and just produced a brochure for 86, 87. So this was already a strategy to use existing activities to show the importance of the field. We got our first premises 5 years after that. We were hosted at the School of Civil Engineering. And in fact, a relevant person in those days was the rector. Our rector for 20 years, Professor Gabriel Ferraté. He is with the vice rector and with Professor Alonso, also a professor in soil mechanics in this university. But I have to acknowledge the contribution of Dr. Ferraté to the development of THEMNE. And all my colleagues from civil engineering. I don't have the picture of all the directors. This is some of the directors. I don't want to name them all. There are many of them missing, like Professor Huerta, who's here, and Professor Diet, the current director. But we were actually a very close together team that we really implemented many important activities without any friction. We were celebrating anniversaries, and THEMNE was making progress. And we were actually supported by our masters. Professor Sienkiewicz chose THEMNE as a place where we'll spend at least 3 months a year for almost 25 years. Actually, for almost 25 years, he was coming every year. Professor Taylor accompanying him almost, I think, over a decade. And this is, I would like also to acknowledge that. And this is a picture of both of them lecturing the days where Oleg, Professor Sienkiewicz, could not see. So they both actually were lecturing, exchanging their views to a classroom of students without any projection of multimedia at all. And we celebrated the 70th birthday of Professor Sienkiewicz. You will recognize many of you in this picture. I will not name all of you. Professor Mang is here. Professor Kleiber is here. Mike Crisfield, Stein, and Professor Mang is there. Bernardo Scheffler, and many of you other who came to celebrate the anniversary of Professor Sienkiewicz. Now, a glimpse about Thymne. How are we organized? Well, we are organized in a very simple manner. There is a governing council that rules the center, and then there is an executive council. And then we have an administration and some research areas. Right. The governing council has 50% members from the government and from the university. It has the rector and the minister now of research and economy, Mr. Villa, and the executive council contains representatives also from the government and from the UPC. Because Thymne is a consortium, it's an independent legal entity. We have our own VAT number. We can hire, we can buy, etc. And we are about 295 people, but of course, excluding the research students, there are about 200 scientists working at Thymne, out of which about 170 are hired by Thymne and 25 belong to the university. They are affiliated scientists. I am a professor at the university and affiliated to Thymne. Okay? Now, Thymne has always been trying to balance research with technology transfer. And now in Spain we have rankings. So there is a ranking in Spain that pick up the 25,000 highest scientists in Spain. We have 60 researchers in this group, which is a very competitive group because it includes all the areas of science, medicine, physics, chemistry, etc. Now, we have expanded over the world after the really effort of our former PhDs in the university. And they have created joint labs. They are called Thymne Classrooms. And we are going to meet with about 20 of them this week in Barcelona. These are the list of classrooms that are in these countries: Argentina, Brazil, Chile, Colombia, Cuba, El Salvador, Guatemala, Mexico, Peru, and Venezuela. So this is an important asset that out of the outcome of these years, this network of places. And also, the government has invested in our premises. We have our offices in Barcelona, in the main campus. Here, this is the main office in Thymne. But only a couple of years ago, we have inaugurated a new building. And this is next to the old. This is the first building. This is the second building. And it's a beautiful building, and it has a fantastic terrace overlooking the sea and the mountain. And there is an inflatable here roof that we use it to protect from the rain and then from the sun here. Okay? And these are other investments in infrastructure in different campuses of the university, because the idea was that we would be distributed, not a single Thymne tower will be distributed over the territory. Now, I will speed up. Our administration staff includes management of projects, training system, publication, human resources, and our general manager is Susana Font. And we have what we call research lines, which are, any list is incomplete, standard lines, multiphysics, fluid dynamics, geomechanics, modeling of materials, optimization, structures, transport. But the staff is in groups, fluid mechanics group, geomechanics, industrial processes, structural mechanics. And these groups are grouped in areas, civil and mechanical engineering, energy and environment, aerospace engineer, excuse me, transport, which is aerospace, naval, and aeronautics, and other areas. So people are in areas, and they all share this research, which areas, topics that are the horizontal. This is a list here of these topics. You can find all this information in the web. But this is something that is we revise all the time. And we are now reconsidering some of these groups in view of the future challenges in engineering. Also, we have started joint ventures. For instance, recently With an Institute of River Dynamics and Hydraulic Engineering, we have created a joint institute that we will use this expertise for experimental analysis of fluid structure interaction problems. And only last May, we have incorporated a center of innovation in transport. This was an independent center that now has become a CIMNE group, and they are experts in transport, mobility, and similar topics in research. We don't have our own courses except training and postgraduate courses, but we support MSc courses in numerical methods in engineering, computational mechanics, and some PhD degrees at the university. CIMNE runs the helps in the secretariat of these courses. But what we actually do is we supervise students. We have supervised 140 PhDs over the last 30 years and about 700 MSc students. These are rough figures. Of course, many of those have been co-supervised with other university professors. But some 20 seminars and what we call CIMNE coffee talks, these are organized by our researchers. They are held annually as part of the dissemination. Let me refer to the publication rate. This is so important nowadays. Well, this is nothing really that will impress any scientific group in the sense when we compete with, because we compete with mathematics and chemistry and physics when we've asked for funding at the national level, and they are really, overcome overtop these numbers. But we publish around 100 papers a year that have some author. And we have our own research publications. Okay, and of course, many of you know this journal Archives, which has a high impact factor. And this journal that started in 85, and this was another excuse, another of the arguments to create CIMNE. It's a journal, and now it's a trilingual journal, Spanish, Portuguese, and English. We also publish their, help to publish the IACM expressions for the IACM. We use the expertise from this publication group. And now recently have launched a new initiative for the open science. I don't have time to talk about it. But basically, this will be the new repository for the CIMNE documents, because actually we can store the documents in the original language with all the videos, etc. And now this is already included here. And this, we hope, this will be an innovation in the way we store and we disseminate the CIMNE outputs and also university outputs. I don't have to stress the activities in conferences. You have heard about the first conferences, and now we have created a group which is specialized in this field, and we help other groups to organize conferences. This is nothing new to many of you, but perhaps you don't know that in 1989 we helped to create the Spanish Society of Numerical Methods in Engineering, and the first conference was in Canary Island in 1990, and since then there are almost 20 conferences have been organized, many of them, the last 12, in cooperation with our colleagues from Portugal. And also I will refer to special events. For instance, this conference organized in Chile with occasion in 1992 in Concepcion. It was the first Latin American conference on numerical methods in engineering and applied science. There have been many others. Also, we helped to create the Mexican Association of in the field, and there was an expedition, you can see here, from the Computational Mechanics Association, Professor Sowen, Scheffler, Belisco, Tom Hughes, and Tinsley Oden. We went to Guanajuato, beautiful place, in January 2002 to support this conference and the creation of the conference in the association in Mexico. Also, this is not a very good picture, but it was a particular event because we were celebrating the 60th birthday of a group of distinguished professors, many of whom are here today. They are 75 now, so congratulations to all of you, including Professor Owen. But the first meeting was in Ibiza in 2002, and here you see Professor Owen, Scheffler, Zienkiewicz, Taylor, and in the other side, Professor Castellero, Oliver, Carlos Felipa, and many others who came to this meeting, and many other conferences that I will not stop here. And of course, the ECOMAS conference in the year 2000 was a big event because we inaugurated the World Trade Center with 2,000 people. We helped to organize with Professor Edelson the World Congress in Buenos Aires in 1998. We also helped Professor Scheffler and his team. I will not name all of them. and organized the World Congress in together with the ECOMAS Conference in Venice. That almost, I think, the group almost close to 3,000 people. And the biggest event so far, hopefully this will be beaten next year in New York, but in Barcelona, a couple of years ago, we organized the largest conference in computational mechanics with 3,000 delegates. And you can see here Professors Oliver and Huerta, who were co-chairs of this conference, the director of the School of Civil Engineering, Professor Olivella, Professor Ram, president of ECOMAS, and Professor Jagawa, president of the AACA in those days. And this is how the room looked. There was another room of the same size where because this room only, we could only take 2,500 people, so there was another room for these 4,000 delegates in this case. This was a large event. And we explore other areas like training, computer-aided training, like parallel computing and transputer application, like social science. We organized a conference, Numerical Methods in Social Science, in the year 2000. These were really opportunities that they used to really explore applications of numerical methods in adjacent fields to engineering. And we also supported a number of scientific societies, as you know, so I don't have to insist that. Now, how about funding? How about how do we survive? Okay, so this is the evolution of theme income over the years. It might look is kind of success story. This is 12 million. So it has been an effort to really sustain this research, mostly through projects. Green is companies. Blue is Europe or international, and red is Spain and global. So mostly these competitive projects have helped to sustain the activities. And in fact, we had almost 600 projects, 670, worth 70 million over the year, and 1,100 projects worth 40 million from industry in those 30 years. Okay, some relevant projects. Well, projects on real-time computing, material design, fluid structure interaction under natural hazards, fusion technology, ship ice interaction. You know, these are projects that were 10 of them funded by the European Research Council. You can find them in our web. And this is how the funding in the last years has been distributed. Companies supporting in red, in blue, Europe and international. Red is competitive in Spain, and of course we have some funding from the government that we are always looking to increase. It's here, and other incomes from technology transfer. Now the question is how this is going to evolve, because this has been a success story out of the work of a really tremendous group of people. This is, I tell you, don't ask me, I don't know. This is going to be a big challenge, okay? So I share with you my concern on where we will go. Of course, I'm more on the red light, but this is like when we organize a conference. We don't know if we're going to be 100 or almost 500 as we are today, okay? So we don't know. But anyway, hopefully technology transfer will help us. Then technology transfer means that the ideas that are born in UPC will mature in theme, will get into something useful, and then we will take it to market. Okay? This is our vision in cooperation with all our joint labs and friends, and also we have created some companies. I tell you, this looks great. We have created almost 16 companies, but I tell you, someone said that this is the best way to lose money, to create companies, unless you are careful. So this is like a feeling. We have planted some little potatoes or tomatoes. Hopefully we will collect them a few years from now. We had some success stories, but this is our challenge. And if we succeed in that, I think the red line will be ensured. But hopefully we need time and, of course, support from the investors to succeed. Couple of notes. One of the most icons of the company is this company doing arc hangars for airplanes. These are structures which are of polyester reinforced with these cables. This is a company. This is 1 minute video. This is a company that is now world leader in this field. I tell you what this means. This. Okay. Because there's no space in the airports for maintenance of airplanes, so they need to have these hangars that bypass the regulations for permanent buildings, and they are used for maintenance of planes, like in this case, airplanes from Airbus, because Cassidian is the Airbus company for what is called MRO, maintenance, repair, and overhauling. These tubes have 5 meters diameter, 5 meter diameter tubes, okay? And they inflate. This is like a dinosaurus waking up, you see? And here, this was the first piece. Now this has 110 meters long. This was 65 only. And this is 58 meters wide, okay? So this is the outcome of our research on rotation-free elements, membrane structures, cables, etc., etc. Okay, this is the airplane inside. And now recently we have taken this technology to transportable bridges for emergencies. This is a tremendous, there is a need to substitute the steel bridges from the Second World War, the Bailey Bridge, and many other bridges. So now we are designing bridges. We have mixed beams, air beams, together with aluminium, some aluminium parts and cables, this tensility concept, and these beams sustain, this bridge will sustain 30 tons and weights really very little, roughly 3 tons. And this is all already tested by the military emergency unit in Spain. Okay, outreaching. How do we actually worry about our dissemination of our research? We have our multimedia channel. We support our soccer teams, our sailing teams. And we really worry. Now with the crisis, we have stopped a bit, but we always have worried about social life. And we go back to the origin of Thymne, always people around the table, eating, in this case, this famous food, calçots, here in the outdoors. You can see here some of our colleagues and staff members. And this is what calçots are. These are like onions that you eat after soaking in a beautiful sauce. And this is going back to porron life. Now, how about the future? A few words about the future, just 2 minutes about the future. Right. We have to keep the excellence in engineering applications. We need to increase our international dimension. We have to keep our participation in societies, and we have to be committed with industry. But these are only words. What actually we would like to do? Well, basically, we don't see now numeric computational methods as an isolated node. This tetrahedral element links knowledge databases, big data, with laboratory experiments to create better products and better processes. I think this is the challenge for Thymne for the next years to come, and I think this is where we are going to focus. And related to specific areas that Europe has defined as interesting areas, manufacturing, transport, environment, and security. Okay, so we are going to put emphasis in all these areas, and our methods will be used for the design of new materials. We have heard today a lecture from Professor Oliver, better manufacturing processes, climate change and the effect on safety and agriculture, and this new field, which is called predictive territory management. Predictive territory management meaning the use of computational methods to enhance activities on the territory. And you can read here all the disciplines, that anything that we do is related to these disciplines. I have left many others out, but I would like to focus on those disciplines: blending methods, material models, artificial intelligence, high-performance computing, and, of course, integration of systems. Because we have here our minister from the territory area, and because we come from civil engineering, I have to tell you that now this is going to be a priority light in Thymne. How to use predictive methods for the better maintenance, design of infrastructures, the enhancement of our transport routes, and the improvement of services. And I think I have already gone through much of my lecture. I don't want to take more time for you. But this is taking the multi-scale approach that is used, for instance, in climate change to the territory. So we start from the applications are enormous, you can see here. Maintenance, durability, new infrastructures, disasters, these emergency situations. But what we do is we take this multi-scale approach to take a part of the world and, for instance, do a tsunami analysis in Chile, for instance. Or to take, for instance, Spain, here focus on what happens in the sea, come to the general map of the Iberian Peninsula. Focus only in Catalonia. Look what is going on when there are explosions here. This is explosions in the city of Barcelona. Looking here to the air quality map in Barcelona. Then looking about the hydraulic events. Looking to the Ebro River, making simulation. This is the tsunami simulation, for instance, in the Barcelona coast. We don't expect tsunamis here, but this is a simulation here. But also in the airport area, this is the airport here. So what will happen if there is some flooding in that region, et cetera, et cetera. Well, dear colleagues, I think I don't want to take more time of you aside. I would like to finish here by saying that we have a challenge ahead to make of Thibne a sustainable organization. And this will imply taking all the knowledge accumulated over 30 years, taking all our contacts and friends, all our assets, and use it for the purpose of increasing, I wrote it, which I didn't read it, the welfare and life of our citizens in general, including security. And I think this includes almost everything, as you can say. And this is the message that we would like to send to our sponsors, to the government, to the city, to the world, and because there is a need for that broad objective, and with that big objective in mind, I think accommodate our computational methods to that broad objective. I'm sure that will not be any method that will be left out. So I think with that, without any further, I will not take much more time. I would like to finish and thank you very much for these 30 years of friendship and cooperation. Thank you very much.